And you gotta grab these things.
Okay. I wanted to do this in a slide presentation, but I figured you can be normal students for a change and have the normal study aids, because I didn't have time to do it all. But this does have to do with aesthetic philosophy, but I'm going to also use it as an opportunity to continue with the biblical narratives that we're dealing with for a couple reasons. One, I have to reclaim time from the missed classes, because we do have to get some serious headway. And I have too much to teach. I have too much to teach you guys on these things. So what I'm going to deal with right now is called the wedding type scene, okay, in the Bible. Now, according to aesthetic philosophy, what I want to actually look at, and this is the idea of, we've looked at how art, what? I did 12. You're going to have to share. Unless, does somebody have an extra one? Either to share or you have to go take one to go make another copy. Oh, that's sweet of you. You just sacrificed yourself like that. I don't know how to make Isaac into a feminine name, but there you go. Ezekiel. Okay. Feel free to run to go do another copy. I need one. Yeah, go do that. Go do that, because Gracie needs one. What was I saying? I forgot what I was saying. No one knows what I was saying. Story of my life. Good for you. Okay, there we go. According to aesthetic philosophy. Okay, we've seen. Now I want to look at something that we've seen in a different way. So what we've seen in going through art forms through subsequent generations and cultures, we've seen two things. One, we've seen how different cultures have different language, different symbols that they communicate ideas with, and that gets incorporated into art, okay? Hence, like, pyramids in Egypt function in according to a certain symbolism, kind of, and in Greece, the order of the columns, the structure of the temples, that functions according to a certain symbolism of the Greeks, who are obsessed with proportion, not necessarily altitude. Okay, the Egyptians like wanted altitude, okay, because everything focused around the sun for them. Whereas, you know, the Greeks were highly into humanism, and so it was like due proportions, and so their temples reflected like a mathematical kind of purity, that order and organization, which is the basis of like why they have philosophy and why they viewed the man, this ideal like proportionate creature with two arms, two legs, two lungs, two nostrils, two ears, one heart. Interesting. Man's not completely symmetrical because the heart's off to the side too. Just saying. Something going on there. Something beautiful there. Okay, fine. Romans inherit it too. So we see development in ideas. We see, according to cultures, things have symbols that communicate ideas. Our last lecture in here actually dealt with Irish art and manuscripts during the Christian period. And there we saw art forms that were still prevalent through like the megalithic carvings age. And why is that? Because they didn't get a huge influx of foreigners into that little island country, okay? Which is why their symbolic structure actually persisted for a very long time in Ireland. So that's one thing. Symbols are important, and they're kind of specified, or they get defined by their cultures. Another thing that we've seen is how also subsequent generations develop an idea. We see changes in plans. We've seen this in architecture where, the Roman triumphal arch, you know, this three portal entryway that's built to commemorate a victory of an emperor or of a general gets taken by the Christians in order to develop a triumphal entry into their churches. And so you end up with like this three portal gateway into cathedrals. Okay. We saw this in the early medieval period. So we see a development, if you will, a changing, if you will. And we will subsequently also see how windows take on different proportions. They get taller. We've already kind of seen, I guess, how the Roman arch, which is a perfect circle, starts to turn into a 3/5 pointed arch. So we see change. Now, one way we can see that is in the progression of an idea of expanding through technique or through science, pushing materials to their limits and like actually building into continual perfection. In a certain sense, we can think of it in terms of evolution, right? You think of something that changes, but the similarity, but it changes. Similarity and it changes and it keeps kind of changing a little bit. We kind of think of that in an evolutionary kind of term. That's one way and that's a valid way, but there's another way that is employed in art. And it's not a development as far as a subsequent phase by which we're like, we're taking the same idea and we're now like changing it and we're trying to perfect it. And then that subsequently gets changed and perfected. Okay, people think of the liturgy in this sense too. Like, there's a way that you can take something, and artists will do this. We will take something that is known by many and we'll change it, but not to perfect it, but rather to bring out something new. Okay, that's already in the original. So you can have something. I think this is used in the visual arts, but I think it's primarily going to be used in literature, in narrative art. And that is, this is like you have a trope, you have a certain story that's very predictable, then you figure it out really quickly. As soon as you see an opening scene of a movie, you know who the good character is and you know who the bad character is. Okay, if it's a Western, the guy in the black hat, bad guy. You watch guy in the white hat, good guy. Like, you automatically know that, okay? The symbols are there. Now, is every Western the same? Like, if it was, you wouldn't watch any Western. You just watch one, you know? You'd be like, okay. I already know how the story's going to end. Forget it. Boring movie. What artists will do is they'll take a very known narrative structure, which has all the elements that we anticipate with our mind. Like, we know how the general way that the story is going to unplay. And but then that what they will do is they'll change details in it. And that functions as a surprise. Because as long as you're working in something that's a known story, you anticipate what will come next. And then as soon as something unexpected happens, you're like, whoa, I didn't see that. You know, the guy in the white hat has a maimed right arm. How is he going to kill the guy in the black hat? I don't know. You know? Or the guy in the black hat is the father of the guy in the white hat, a.k.a. Star Wars. Whoa, that's huge. Like, you know, like, I wasn't seeing that one coming. So you can take a story that's similar, and you want to use a story that's similar because it causes, in a certain sense, all the elements of the story are present in the person's imagination because they're familiar with the story. And then the artist will change details in it in order to cause the surprise. Okay? So this isn't like an evolutionary change. This is, no, I'm going to work within this sequence so that people understand the story and so that I can manipulate it for an artistic effect. That will teach more possibilities that we're always possessed within this little story type thing. Okay? You kind of see that? So you can find stories that are quite, quite old. This is like, we're getting in the realm of fairy tales here. Okay? You can find stories that are really old. And the narrative arcs are all the same. And the characters' names might change, but their roles are all very similar. And they all go through the similar, very predictable phases. Okay, but these stories are very good to us. Like, they're pleasing to us. And what makes them great stories is when all of a sudden, or when the artist shows his craft is when he actually alters the details, which causes surprise. But the only reason why it surprises us is because we were thinking it would be something else. But then he does something different. And the only reason why we thought it was going to be something else is because he chose to work in a story that was predictable to us a little bit. That's an important thing. So this shows you, I think, actually, that part of creativity sometimes has to rely on using something that is quite old and predictable. Okay? Now that is like, that's a philosophical like look at what I'm going to call a type scene. And I think this is more prevalent in narrative arcs. And I think this is really important, and I haven't done like exhaustive study in these kinds of things, but you do find common stories too, like common elements in certain saint stories, saint lives, especially from the medieval period, where it's like, I think they're just confusing it with this other saint because all the details of their life are kind of the same, you know? Or like Saint George, okay? Knight, princess, dragon, okay. Like, I'm kind of confused right now. Is it Saint George or is it like Sleeping Beauty? You see what I'm saying? My personal opinion is actually that since the chief form of entertainment was religion, okay, in the medieval period, they weren't so obsessed with history as we think. I think they were more loose with their details in order to storytell in some things. That doesn't mean they're lying. That means like the meaning of what's going on there is true, though the characters and the details of the stories just facilitate the meaning. Okay, don't get hung up on details. Rather, what is the point of the thing? What is the meaning of the story? It seems to me that I think the medieval period would do things. Use type scenes for saint biography, for hagiography. And we look back at that and we go like, oh, stupid medieval period, who don't, like, they, like, so fanciful. Like, well, that's not fair. Like, you guys obsess with watching stories of, you know, guys who snap their finger and, you know, half the universe disappears. I mean, how much time do we spend watching movies and things like that? Okay, get rid of Hollywood, get rid of everything, and all you have is all of your chief festival days all revolve around your liturgical calendar. All your, like, bedtimes, where are your bedtime stories going to be? They're going to be about saints, they're going to be about religious figures, the people that you always, like, hear about, the people you're named after. Who are you going to story tell about? Exactly. Yeah? So don't get hung up on, like, stupid medieval. No, they had great imaginations, but that's because, like, these were stories that we all need to know. They ended up just, like, using characters from their culture, okay? The heroes of the faith, okay? Anyway, we're going to go into the Bible and look at how the Bible will use these things. Now, I've skipped one of them. We've already been introduced to one, which is, like, it's called kind of like the matriarch in trouble type scene. It's a common story. It shows up three times. Sarah is abducted by Pharaoh. She's abducted by Abimelech. And Rebecca will be abducted by Abimelech. Okay? It's a very similar story. Yes, we have a guest in the other house who's going to flight school right now. Don't ask me. My boss. So don't be distracted. So, very predictable story. It shows up. Threefold. What? What was I saying? It's told three times in the book of Genesis, okay? Oh, it's just duplication. Oh, somebody like messed up the scrolls and they're just copy-pasting it. No, okay, the way that you would read it is, okay, this is a predictable narrative, a story of a matriarch in trouble, especially in the Abraham narrative. Like, it's the matriarch needs to be there because he has to have a kid, which means he needs a wife. So her abduction is a problem to be overcome for, you know, the future progeny. Because the promise of God is going to come through her. And so her abduction is this like really kind of like crisis of salvation history. And so when Sarah's abducted by Pharaoh, you know, crisis mode. When she's abducted by Abimelech, crisis mode. And when Rebecca is abducted from Isaac, crisis mode, okay? Because he hasn't had any kids yet, okay? And he's only going to have two. He's going to have twins. Anyway, so it uses a similar story. It has predictable elements, but it has distinctions in them. And it's in the distinctions where the surprise is supposed to be, okay, which reveals the main message of the story. Now I'm going to look at another type scene. And this one I think is a little bit more important, and it's more heavily employed in the Old Testament and in the New. Okay, and this is called the wedding type scene. So this is the movie about the wedding. Okay, how does Hollywood do it now? Well, probably opening scene, you have like Bridezilla or something. I don't know. You know, some woman writing an email, like talking to another woman about a guy or something like that. Like, you know, you're immediately you're in a romance. Okay? It opens with a woman or a depressed guy. You know you're immediately like in a romance. Okay. In the Bible, the main symbol isn't like a woman on a computer or talking to other women or a depressed guy. The main symbol is opening scene. A well. A well is like church bells. Okay? Well is church bells. According to this, the Semitic culture of the Middle East. Now, why would... Yeah, obviously, we've already seen actually how Hagar's like dying without water in the wilderness. Abram had to go to Egypt because there's no water. Like, to not have water in the desert is to be dead. What?
So,
yes.
When they come together, they have life.
Yes. That's right. And life comes out of what? When you have a kid, who does it come out of? Does it come out of the father or the mother? It comes out of the mother. Okay. We know that much about the birds and bees. Okay. Okay. What? Unless it's a seahorse. We're not doing that. Get out of here. We're not writing stories for seahorses. We're writing stories for man. Okay. So life comes out of the mother. Yeah, and life comes out of the ground in the well. Okay, life is water if you're in the desert. Okay, and so a well is a symbol for a woman. A well is a symbol for a woman. It's a feminine symbol. It never means man. Okay, it's a feminine symbol. Now, this first subtitle I have here. Now, I'm just showing you actually. Looking at the language of the Bible, looking at how it uses symbols according to its culture. I have two different citations here. One is from the Song of Songs and one is from Proverbs. Okay, in the Song of Songs, this is how it describes this bride. A garden locked away is my sister, my bride, a garden locked, a fountain sealed. Okay, a fountain, a source of water that comes out of the earth is what his bride is called here in the Song of Songs. It's sealed, it's concealed, okay, because she's going to belong just to him, okay? And she's an enclosed garden. Like, nobody else can go in there except her, him. That's how Solomon's speaking of his bride here. In the book of Proverbs, here's another use of it, okay? Drink water from your own cistern, flowing water from your own well, okay? Referring to the cistern is the wife, okay? Drink water, flowing water from your own well is referring to the act, okay? Through which the well woman brings out more life, okay? It's talking about the conjugal act here. Should your springs be scattered abroad, streams of water in the streets, don't let her, like, give her water all over the place, okay? Let them be for yourself alone and not for strangers with you. Let your fountain be blessed and rejoice in the wife of your youth. Okay, again, fountain, woman, okay? And the water's flowing from it. Or the life-giving acts, the generative acts. That husband and wife do. Okay, now, I throw this one in here just so you can see, like, our Roman Missal, like, we're of a distinct culture. We're from Rome. We're not from ancient Semitic. But the thing is that liturgy uses the Bible, biblical theology, for its prayers, which is why in order to actually understand the prayers of Christianity, you have to actually understand the Bible. And this was a big problem for many, 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 many years, which is that scripture study became kind of really, really primitive. And so people's understanding of the ritual became very, very primitive, okay? Especially with the Old Testament. So look at this, what the Roman Missal talks about. May he be a secret mixture. Now this is the blessing on the baptismal font on Holy Saturday. Of his divine virtue, rendering this water fruitful for the regeneration of men, to the end that a heavenly offspring conceived by sanctification may emerge from the immaculate womb of this divine font, reborn a new creature, and may all, however distinguished in body, by sex, or in time, by age, be mother-born into one same infancy by grace. Calls the baptismal fountain a womb through which people are born. Okay? It's completely taking this from the Bible. Okay? A well is a symbol for a woman. Okay? Because life is born from woman. What? Contribute. Speak loud. Be bold. Somebody. No? Okay. Okay. That's one of the main cultural symbols that we have to deal with. Okay, when it comes to wedding type C. You see a well, you think, ooh, okay. Something going on with wedding here, maybe, possibly, of husband and wife. Okay? That's our first kind of like big thing. Elements of a scene. Okay, is a big citation I'm taking from actually a Jewish translator of the Bible, who is a professional literary critic. Okay, this guy's actually like, he's pretty neat because he wasn't really ever a scripture scholar, but he was like this Jew that like worked in literary criticism. He was like I don't know if he was in a university position, but the thing is he's an art critic, okay? And he's a narrative specialist. And he took his craft and started looking at the Bible. And he was like, wow, there's some actually cool artistry going on in these things. And he brought an outsider's perspective, and he kind of actually shamed all the professionals who were really like obsessed with like what this word means. And he was like, wait, there's all kinds of cool things going on if you look at the form criticism, okay? And he's the one that really coined this like wedding type scene thing. Yes, ma'am.
Oh, when the Jews, when like Mary and Joseph, they were betrothed, so they got married and then they didn't have common life or they weren't supposed to for a year. When did that start, that tradition?
What does that have to do with my current lecture?
How's my marriage?
Come on, man. I don't know when that started. Give me a break. I don't know. I gotta stick with my wedding type scene, okay? Betrothal scene is something different. No, it's not. It's not the same thing, okay? Because it doesn't start with a well. That's what... my movie starts with a well, okay? My movie starts with a well. What? I'm not saying like all... okay, all things that deal with matrimony don't fit into this type scene. All aspects of it don't. Okay? That's not how the story goes. Can we wait till we get to the fifth page? You guys are hijacking my lecture completely. When I want dialogue and classroom participation, you guys never do it. And now you guys are like pirates, though, when I don't want you to do it. You're like getting...
How did you know it's there?
Okay. Well, good. I like that you're both thinking. That's good. And one of you is like... thinking really well. You're already projecting details. Good for you. Because there's a well at the beginning of that chapter. In John chapter 5. I think it's 5. It's 4. Sorry. But as far as Mary and Joseph's betrothal scene, there's no well there. So it's not in that type scene. Okay. Okay. I'm not going to read the elements of the scene because I'm going to reveal them to you as we go through our first what? Okay. Turn the page. D. These are our elements of the scene. These things repeat with such a consistency that they're basically the framework of the story of someone getting married. Okay? And it's going to be these kinds of details, that these predictable details that the author will throw his surprises in there. Okay? Or reveal things about the characters. The first thing is, and that I've highlighted them in this first one. I didn't do it in the subsequent ones. But in this first one, okay, this is dealing with Eleazar. This is Isaac and Rebekah's marriage scene. Eleazar went to Mesopotamia, okay? That's your first element. Foreign man in a foreign land, okay? Because the wife is someone that you have to go a long way to get, okay? It's a hard journey to find a wife. Especially if she's going to be a good wife. I guess it's not a hard journey if you want to find a bad wife. But if you want to find a good wife, that's a long, hard journey. Okay? Be suspect if it comes easy. Be real suspect. Foreign man in a foreign land. Now. And he made the camels kneel down outside the city by the well of water. Okay? Foreign man in a foreign land, a well. Bam. Second element. Now in our story here, at the time of evening, the time when women go out to draw water, he said, "O Lord, God of my master Abraham, grant me success today, I beg you, and show mercy to my master Abraham. Behold, I am standing by the spring of water. The daughters of the men of the city are coming out to draw water. Let the maiden to whom I shall say, please let down your jar that I may drink. And who shall say, drink, and I will water your camels? Let her be the one whom you have appointed for your servant Isaac. By this I shall know that you have shown mercy to my master." Before he had done speaking, behold, Rebekah, who was born to Bethuel, the son of Milcah, the wife of Nahor, Abraham's brother, came out with her water jar upon her shoulder. The maiden was very fair to look upon, a virgin. Third element is a maiden. Okay? Four men in foreign land, a well, a maiden. You can already see John chapter 4. I'm not married. Yeah, you've been married five times to the man you're currently with. You're not married to the man you're currently with, and you already have five husbands, you know, type deal. Whoa, that's a big surprise. I thought you were supposed to be a maiden, you know? Different kind of maiden. Okay. Yeah, she's not currently married because she's in an invalid marriage because she's already married. Whom no man had known, she went down to the spring, filled her jar, came up. Then the servant ran to meet her and said, "Please, give me a little water to drink from your jar." And she said, "Drink, my lord." And she quickly let down her jar upon her hand and gave him to drink. Fourth element is somebody drinks water. Okay? It's not going to be that the woman gives water. Okay? It's because that water comes out of the well. Okay? Life does come out of the well. One of the things that's going to shift and in surprising ways is who brings the water out. And that's supposed to reveal actually things about the characters in the story. And I'm going to get back into that. I'm just going to continue reading. When she had finished giving him a drink, she said, "I will draw for your camels also until they have done drinking." So she quickly emptied her jar into the trough and ran again to the well to draw. And she drew for all his camels. The man gazed at her in silence to learn whether the Lord had prospered his journey or not. When the camels had done drinking, the woman took a gold ring weighing half a shekel, two bracelets for her arms weighing 10 gold shekels. And he said, "Tell me whose daughter you are. Is there room in your father's house for us to lodge in?" And she said, "I am the daughter of Bethuel, the son of Milcah, whom she bore to Nahor." And she said, "We have both straw and food enough and room to lodge in." The man bowed his head and worshipped the Lord and said, "Blessed be the Lord, the God of my master Abraham, who has not forsaken his mercy and his faithfulness towards my master. As for me, the Lord has led me in the way to the house of my master's kinsman. Then the maiden ran and told her mother's household about these things. That's our fifth element. This is a running virgin, a running maiden. The one running, okay? This is a happy event.
It's almost like when she runs to Elizabeth, too.
Who? Wait. Oh, Mary. We're going to have to think about this one. Okay, you guys are going to that. That's good. I like how you're thinking. That's good. I'm going to, Holly, you have to write me a paper on this.
Oh.
Yeah, you write me a paper on this.
Do I get extra credit?
Yeah, I'll give you an A++. Okay, running maiden. Okay, Rebecca had a brother whose name was Laban. Laban ran out to meet the man to the spring when he saw the ring, the braces on his arms, and when he heard the words of Rebecca, his sister says, "Thus the man spoke to me." He went to the man, and behold, he was standing by the camels at the spring. Actually, to tell you the truth, the fact that Laban notices all these, like, the gold and the money and stuff on Rebecca kind of shows you actually how Laban is, okay? He's like, ooh, wait, coin, hey, this guy's some rich things. This is revealing stuff actually about Laban's character that you're going to get in Jacob's narrative, because Laban is going to be the uncle that tricks Jacob into working for, like, 14 years, okay? He's like, he likes the gold and shiny things. He likes getting... He said, "Come in, O blessed of the Lord. Why do you stand outside? For I have prepared the house and a place for the camels." So the man came into the house. Why? Because he has great precious gifts, huh? And Laban ungirded the camels and gave him straw and food for the camels and water to wash his feet and the feet of the men who were with him. Then food was set before him to eat. And he said, "I will not eat until I have told my errand." And the men who were with him ate and drank. Okay, I skipped a bunch of verses there where he tells the whole story. And they spent, and then at verse 54 is they eat. Okay, but food is put before them and the meal is exchanged. That means the marriage contract has happened. Okay, that's your last element. Always ends with a meal. So these are the main narrative arcs of a wedding type scene in the Bible. Now, in this Isaac and Rebecca account, we have some very interesting things that reveal things about the characters involved. First of all, the four men of foreign land is Eleazar. It's not Isaac. Okay? As we're going to see, when this type scene is used subsequently, it's going to be the person who actually gets married is going to be the man in the foreign land. Jacob is going to go to the foreign land and go to a well. Moses is going to go to a foreign land and go to a well. Christ is going to go to a foreign land and sit at a well. Okay? But in Isaac's story alone, Isaac has nowhere. He's not even in his own wedding type scene. Huh? I know. And didn't I already tell you? Like, everything happens to Isaac. Like, Isaac is like, doesn't do anything to anybody. He doesn't even pick his own wife. Okay? Somebody else does that for him. Never leaves the land. Now, the maiden of all the type scenes that we will look at, this is the only one where Rebecca draws water, okay? It's Rebecca that gives water to Eleazar. And not only that, how does it put it? Look at, like, the way that it gives the verbs, actually. "And she quickly did down her jar upon her hand and gave him to drink." Quickly, she like "Here, take some water." And then she goes, "And now I'll water your camels." And she runs back and forth, feet watering all the camels. How many times does she run back and forth? I don't know. 10. The thing is that Rebecca is revealed as like this really dynamic, energetic woman who gets things done. Okay? And she is going to be the one that travels all the way to the homeland in order to marry her husband. And she is going to be the one that actually is going to orchestrate who gets the inheritance of her children. She is the one that's going to actually be doing things for her son and for Isaac. Like, she's the one that does things. She gets things done. And so in this type scene, that's the kind of the surprise. Like, whoa, wait, who's this woman, man? She's just like watering everybody. Okay? Leah doesn't do that. Neither does Rachel. Zipporah doesn't do that. We'll have to get to John 5. Something interesting goes on there. What else? The maiden ran and told the mother's household these things. Okay. And the food was set before him to eat. So, And then there's that long break between the food and them actually finally eating it. And what's in between there is her actually making the decision to go, okay, and to get married. That's when the meal is finally completed. And so we do have sort of this, like, by using this type scene, we know exactly that we're in a marriage situation, but we also start learning things about the different characters involved. Isaac, his absence, Rebecca, her dynamism, and also how everything kind of hinges on her decision to actually get married to Isaac. Okay? Doesn't happen in the other ones that way at all. Okay, so this is a good representative. This is the first time the type scene has shown up. Now, let's look at Jacob and Rachel. Genesis 29, 1 through 22. And Jacob. So you want to mark on these papers because then you can very easily use these to then mark in your Bible later on in a clean, orderly fashion. And Jacob went on his journey and came to the land of the people of the east, foreign man, foreign land. As he looked, he saw a well in the field. Oh, foreign man, foreign land, well. Okay, marriage bells. Dun, 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 dun. And behold, three flocks of sheep lying beside it. For out of that well the flocks were watered. Okay, there's going to be watering going on. Who's going to water? Where's the watering? The stone on the well's mouth was large. Whoa, that's new. This well is closed with a large stone. Box large, okay? Huh? Well, that's good, but that's not where I'm going. Box large. And when all the flocks were gathered together, you guys are actually getting this, so I like this. The shepherds would roll the stone. And when all the flocks were gathered together, the shepherds would roll the stone from the mouth of the well, and the water the sheep, and put the stone back in its place upon the mouth of the well. So it gives you this, like, there's a local custom to this well. There's a time when the watering is supposed to be done. And there's an order through which you do it. Okay? You have to wait for everybody to be there. Then you unseal the well. Then you water. And then you seal the well back up. Jacob said to them, "My brothers, where do you come from?" And they said, "We are from Haran." He said to them, "Do you know Laban, the son of Nahor?" They said, "We know him." And he said to them, "It is well with him." They said, "It is well. And see, Rachel, his daughter, is coming with the sheep." Uh-oh. He said, "Behold, it is still high day. It is not time for the animals to be gathered together. Water the sheep and go and pasture them." Okay, so Rachel's coming. Okay, but he tells us too, hey, it's not the time to water the sheep yet. The well's not supposed to be unsealed right now. But they said to him, "We cannot until all the flocks are gathered together and the stone is rolled from the mouth of the well. Then we water the sheep." Again, so there's this whole rule. There's a protocol of how you're supposed to give the water. Okay? Jacob wants to hurry up and water Rachel's sheep. Okay? And everyone, they're like, "No, no, no, you got to wait for everybody to get here." Okay? That's the custom of our country. Don't break any rules here. Yeah, okay. There's rules with this well. And Jacob is trying to break them. While he was still speaking with them, Rachel came with her father's sheep, for she kept. Now, when Jacob saw Rachel, the daughter of Laban, his mother's brother, and the sheep of Laban, his mother's brother, Jacob went up and rolled the stone from the well's mouth and watered the flock of Laban, his mother's brother. And Rachel's the maiden, okay? We know she's a maiden. It doesn't tell us explicitly, but we know she's the woman. We just presuppose she's a maiden. And so what happens here? Okay, so we have the water. Jacob goes up, rolls the stone from the well's mouth, watered the flock of Laban, his mother's brother. Okay, Jacob, what does Jacob do? He breaks the local rule on how to get the water in order to hurry up and get the water for Rachel. Okay, and this is exactly what he's going to do after he accidentally marries Leah. What does his brother say? "It is not our custom for the younger to be given away before the older." Okay, so Jacob, in his wedding type scene, breaks the local custom to get to Rachel. And in his actual wedding night, the local custom gets thrown back in his face. The large stone on the well is also going to be the word that's used to describe Leah, who is large, okay? Okay, which we tend to think of as she's the fat sister, but large could also mean great. That's how the Hebrews would understand Leah, because out of her come both the kingly line and the priestly line, which is why she's great. What?
Could it also mean she was prideful?
What? No, she's a come off of prideful. I guess you could say that, but... But that's not comes out in her character. I mean, you could accuse her of that, but I don't know how you'd argue it. Write me a paper proving me that she's prideful, and you'll see how hard it is. Okay? But she's the symbolic stone that has to be removed, okay, in order to get to the well. Jacob has to marry Leah before he gets to Rachel, okay? But that's all kind of built into his type scene a little bit, as the story reveals itself. When Laban heard the tidings of Jacob, his sister's son, he ran to meet him and embraced him and kissed him and brought him into his house. And Jacob told Laban all these things. Laban said to him, "Surely you are my bone and my flesh." And he stayed with him a month. My bone and my flesh. Okay, so we already just know, like, okay, the fact that, okay, Laban, who's about to trick Jacob, says, "You're bone and my bone and flesh." We think immediately, yeah, they're family ties. But the only other time that we get that is actually from Genesis chapter 2, which is the fitting helpmate of Adam. Oh, surely this is bone of my bone. The fitting helpmate of Jacob is Laban. Okay, Jacob just tricked his dad into giving him his own giving him Esau's inheritance. He stole from the younger stole from the older, and now Laban, his fitting helpmate, is going to give him the older while he tries to steal the younger. It's like the trickster gets tricked. This is kind of like the trope. It's kind of cool. And Laban said to Jacob, "Because you are my kinsman, should you therefore serve me for nothing? Tell me, what shall your wages be?" Now Laban had two daughters. The name of the older was Leah, and the name of the younger was Rachel. Leah's eyes were weak, but Rachel was beautiful and lovely. Okay, the older. Okay, that older word is actually large. The greater, the large one. Jacob loved Rachel, and he said, "I will serve you 7 years for your younger daughter Rachel." Laban said, "It is better that I give her to you than that I should give her to any other man. Stay with me." So Jacob served 7 years for Rachel, and they seemed to him but a few days because of the love he had for her. Then Jacob said to Laban, "Give me my wife that I may go into her, for my time is completed." So Laban gathered together all the men of the place and made a great feast. Okay, so there you have your meal. At the very end of the 7 years of labor, which seemed but a day, and it took one paragraph in the Bible to tell you about it. And we all know. He marries Leah. The stone on top of the well. Okay, Moses and Zipporah. And Moses fled from Pharaoh and stayed in the land of Midian. And he sat down by a well. Four men, foreign land, Moses in Midian. Well. Now the priests of Midian had 7 daughters, and they came and drew water and filled the troughs to water their father's flock. You have the maidens coming, okay, to draw water. And Moses is there. The shepherds came and drove them away. Then you have these other shepherds who are hostile to these daughters, okay, who are attacking them. Okay, with Jacob, it was like this legal custom on how the proper way of getting the water, okay? In the story with Rebecca, it's her activity in providing water for, like, everybody. And in Exodus, what's the context is nobody can get to the water because these shepherds keep, like, beating back the women, okay? They drive them away. But Moses stood up. He witnesses this injustice, huh? And helped them and watered their flock. So Moses defends the ladies, okay? Drives away the aggressors, and he provides water to them. Hey, that's kind of fitting to his character of who he is in salvation history. It is he who delivers the people from the Egyptians. It is he that will provide them water in the desert. Okay? And so it's built into his marriage scene likewise.
He's also delivered from the water himself.
And he's going to be delivered from the water himself. In the Red Sea. What? When he's a baby.
And the woman delivers him.
Yeah, and then he delivers the woman.
Wait, but he's delivered from the water.
Yeah, and then he delivers.
Moshe, huh? Yeah. And now he delivers. I don't know. There might be something there. He provides life water. That's true, though. I like he has delivered from the water. That's what his name means. And he will deliver the people from the water. And in this case, in his marriage ceremony, it's him that delivers the water and gives it to the people. Okay, so you're not off base. You're like, good, I like it. You're connecting the dots. When they come to their father Arul, he said, how is it that you have come so soon today? Yeah, because every time you go out there, you're always harassed. They said, an Egyptian delivered us out of the land of the shepherds and even drew water for us and watered the flock. He said to his daughters, where is he? Why have you left a man? Call him, that he may eat bread. And Moses was content to dwell the man, and he gave Moses his daughter Zipporah. Okay, so they ate. Moses goes there, he eats bread. Okay, that's Moses' wedding scene. Quite short. I'm going to skip Ruth and Boaz, okay? It's like kind of like a really creative adaptation. In this one, it's like, the woman is the foreigner in a foreign land. There's no well, but there's these jugs of water. You can kind of see that the elements are kind of there in sort of a rudimentary kind of really creative way to let you know those are really close to detail, that you're in a wedding type scene. But I don't want to go into that in detail. I want to go into Saul's short-lived reign in 1 Samuel 9, 11, 14, because this one will use the convention. As they went up the hill to the city, they met young maidens coming out to draw water and said to them, is the seer here? So you see young maidens and you see water and a well. You immediately think biblical type scene for a wedding. And this is Saul. And Saul's not married yet. And they answered, he is. Behold, he is just ahead of you. Make haste. He has come just now to the city because the people have a sacrifice today on the high place. As soon as you enter the city, you will find him before he goes up to the high place to eat. For the people will not eat till he comes. And you got this whole like, hey, there's going to be this meal. Go up there so you can have the meal. Since he must bless the sacrifice, afterward those who are invited. Now go up, for you will meet him immediately. So they went up to the city, and as they were entering the city, they saw Samuel coming out toward them on his way up to the high place. Okay, this is a marriage scene that is aborted, okay? It gives you, like, the context. You're expecting a marriage scene. He's supposed to go up. You had these maidens here. You had water. He's supposed to go up there and have a meal. But this is where, actually, the crown gets stripped from Saul. He doesn't get his wife in his marriage scene because he's going to lose his kingdom too to David. Okay? It's almost like a... It uses a predictable scene. The surprise is that it actually never comes to fruition, which is exactly what's going to happen to Saul's kingdom. Yeah? That's pretty cool, huh? This is why in Pius the Tenth, I forget the encyclical that we studied, when I said, like, just as Christ was everything like man save for sin, the Bible also uses all things of art save for error. Like, anything that human artistry can employ, the Bible also employs, okay? And that's exactly how these stories are kind of functioning. John chapter 4. Now, when the Lord knew that the Pharisees had heard that Jesus was making and baptizing more disciples than John, although Jesus himself did not baptize, but only his disciples. First of all, he left Judea and departed again to Galilee, and he had to pass through Samaria. So he came to a city of Samaria called Sychar near the field that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there. And so Jesus, wearied as he was with his journey, sat down beside the well. It was about the sixth hour. Foreign man in a foreign land. Christ is in Samaria. He sits down by a well. And we would do well, I think, to know that this is prologued with the disciples of John and baptizing. Okay? That's going to be an important detail in order to understand this type scene. There came a woman of Samaria to draw water. Ooh, is this the maiden? Yes, to draw water. And Jesus said to her, "Give me to drink." For his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask a drink of me, a Samaritan woman?" Like, yeah, hey, what would it mean? I mean, according to the old type scenes, like a Jew is going to marry a Samaritan? That's like anathema, you know, in the New Testament. It's like, what is going on here? For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans. Yeah, and especially not marriage. Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." Okay, wait a minute. Wait. Who's giving water to who here? Christ is going to give water? He asked her for water, but he's going to give another type of water. It's going to be a this is a symbol going on here. It's two types of water, physical water and a spiritual water. He's asking for a physical from this woman, and he will provide a spiritual back to her. The woman said to her, "Sir, you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Deep from the earth?" Yeah, that's the question there. "Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself and his sons and his cattle?" And Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him will never thirst. The water that I shall give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life." Okay, I'm better than your father Jacob, who made this well that gives water from the ground, because I put a well within each man's soul, which will continually give them living water unto everlasting life. Okay, so Christ's water is going to be grace. Okay, that's what his marriage is going to function on, is this living water. There's this physical water aspect too, which the Samaritan woman is supposed to provide him. Okay. This is how we see the linking of the two waters, if you will. It's in baptism when these two things are linked. Okay, with physical water, all of a sudden we have a living water within our soul of grace, which is for eternal life, not eternal life here on earth, but eternal life in heaven. The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water that I may not thirst nor come here to draw," because she's still thinking about this current well. She's like, "Yes, I like this water. I'll never have to drink again. That's awesome." Jesus said to her, "Go, call your husband and come here." The woman answered him, "I have no husband." Oh, yeah, it's a maiden. Is he going to marry her? That's kind of cool. She doesn't have a husband. Jesus said to her, "You are right in saying I have no husband." Oh, look, she's not married. She's eligible to be married. "For you have had five husbands." Whoa, she's not a maiden at all. Okay. "And he whom you now have is not your husband. This you said truly." Like, okay, this is like a really interesting kind of marriage going on here. Okay? This woman's been married to lots of different people. That's also the number of, if I remember correctly, the number of foreigners imported to Samaria was five. Okay, so this is actually, she kind of becomes a symbol of actually all the Jews that abandoned the faith and got integrated with the Gentiles in a certain sense. The woman said to him, "Sir, I perceive that you are a prophet." I love that. I was like, I perceive that, you got me figured out. That's right. I've had lots of husbands. And I'm currently living with a guy that's not my husband. Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father." Oh, I'm sorry. I skipped a line. "Our fathers worshiped on this mountain. You say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship." And she goes, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming and now is, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For such the Father seeks to worship him." Okay, so Christ frames this whole idea. okay? Of, you won't worship on this mountain or that mountain, okay? Because that's a big thing. The Samaritans had their own cult mountain that was distinct from Jerusalem. Now, he says, you won't worship on this mountain or that mountain. And then later on, he says, you're not going to worship on any mountains, but everywhere in spirit and truth. In between that, you have this whole idea that salvation comes from the Jews, okay? Like, the husband has to come from the Jews. The true husband comes from the Jews. That's how we're going to be thinking about this in the biblical type scene, if you will. You worship what you do not know. But because Christ is dislodging everything from this physical well, physical water, it becomes a spiritual reality. It's not going to be tied to a location. It's going to be tied to a belief system. This marriage is going to be tied to a belief system and who the true groom is. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and in truth. The woman said to him, I know that Messiah is coming, that the Messiah is coming. He who is called Christ, when he comes, he will show us all things. And Jesus said to her, I who speak to you am he. Just then his disciples came. They marveled that he was talking with a woman. Is he going to buy a well? Is he going to marry her? What the heck's going on here? But none said, what do you wish, or why are you talking with her? So the woman left her water jar, went away into the city. Okay, a woman running to the city, and said to the people, come, see a man who told me all that I ever did. Can this be the Christ? They went out of the city and were coming to him. Meanwhile, the disciples begged him, saying, Rabbi, eat. And he said to them, I have food to eat of which you do not know. So the disciples said to one another, has anyone brought him food? And Jesus said to them, my food is to do the will of him who sent me and to accomplish his work. Okay? You even have the food there, but it's spiritual food. Okay? In this type scene that John has completely repackaged. Now, you can, by all means, you read this as a historical event, but the thing is that the meaning of the event is going to be layered on top of this type scene that we see employed throughout the Old Testament. Christ's wedding scene revolves around a sinner, a very bad sinner, a non-Jew who's going to be incorporated into, okay, the one body, huh, of the church. And the means of the marriage is not going to be through drinking out of a physical well. It's going to be by receiving a very spiritual water, that which comes from baptism, okay? And those who are baptized will live forever, okay? And they even have their own spiritual food, which is to do the will of God. Okay. Any questions? Is there more things there? Absolutely. But that's all I'm going to go through right there. Cool? Cool. Hey, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, amen. Glory be to the Father, the Son, the Holy Ghost. Benedictio Deum tentis, no patris et filii, spiritus sancti, just in a super vos, in my semper. Amen.